Yes. Good morning. We are going to talking about chapter 8. On the chapter 8, the chapter gonna talking about the combined loading. What is mean by combined loading? The structure typically, as you may see from the example A. When you consider this structure, let this structure subjected to the external force of 10 kilonewton and follow what we known from what engine static. We will use the knowledge of the engine static to what? To find or to determine the internal force and the internal moment. However, before you can find the internal force and internal moment, sometimes you require to draw the free body diagram. And then you got to find the reaction. For example, the structure over here, when it's subjected to 10 kilonewton, and this is the pin. So the pin supposed to have the reaction at point A. Let's say this is going to be A sub X. This is going to be A sub Y. And also under the application of 10 kilonewton force, the beam trying to rotate in this direction. So the cable will develop the force. For example, this is going to be F sub B. Following this one, if you know this is 1 meter, this is 1 meter, this 1 meter, and this is 45 degree, you can determine the reaction of F sub B and also of the A sub X and A sub Y by what? By using what we have is equation of equilibrium. Then typically the problem will ask you to determine the internal force and internal moment from a given section, let's say from this section. So this step, you guys supposed to be able again draw the free body diagram of this portion. So if you have this one, for sure, you may cut the section at the yellow one, and then you can put the known force. Now, this is going to be 10 kilonewton, and also you already know the reaction of A sub X and of A sub Y. And under the application of the external force 10 kilonewton and also the A sub X and A sub Y, typically you may have the moment to resist the rotation. And also you need to have the shear force to prevent the vertical movement. And also you need to have the normal axial force to prevent the movement in the horizontal direction. And that is called the internal force and internal moment. Now, the step is just like what we have over here. And then we move to the second one. Second one is the knowledge of the mechanics of materials. This second one, you have the normal force. So you have the normal stress due to the normal force. You also have the moment. The moment generate the stress. That is going to be sigma equal to my over I and the shear. Now, the shear force called the transverse shear. We have the equation VQ over IT. Okay, so typically you just determine the stresses, and I recommend some very important equation. This is three of them. And in the introduction of chapter 8, they're talking about the vessel. It can be cylindrical vessel and spherical vessel. In the vessel is a kind of, for example, the pipe. The pipe that we have to send the natural gas in Thailand. Those pipes have kind of circular section and it has the natural gas pressure. Typically, it is P, okay? And then sometimes it may be P sub I. Since the pipe is circle, so typically the pipe also have the diameter, and the radius of the pipe is the diameter divided by 2. And then, as you may know, the pipe also have its thickness. Since the thickness of the pipe is very small, such as 1 millimeter or 2 millimeter, most of the time, the ratio between R over T going to be larger than or equal to 10. So we call this kind of cylinder or this kind of pipe as the thin walled and pressure vessel. And follow what you consider from the introduction, we have equation. Talking about the balloon, when you blow the balloon will get bigger, bigger, and bigger. So if you take this one and you guys thinking about the pressure vessel subjected to the pressure, and then if you just consider a small element, which is the material of the pipe, thinking about the cylinder, the balloon, okay? The balloon, when you blow the balloon get bigger and bigger. There is the stress in this direction and in this direction. And follow what we have in the introduction. This called sigma 1 is going to be the pressure times the radius and divided by T. This is 2T, this called sigma 2. And we have also the pressure over here is called sigma 1. It's going to be PR over T. And you may see the sigma 1 always larger than sigma 2 for cylindrical pipe. So we have two equations of sigma 1 and sigma 2 over here. And then there is another thing called spherical cylinder. If you go to petrochemical industry, there is the storage tank such as a pressure storage tank. Those kind of tank in the PowerPoint have this kind of spherical like a ball. Why? Why this kind of big structure have the shape like a ball? This time again, you consider a small element. The spherical provide very important thing. The stress that occur on both direction is going to be sigma 2. It's going to be PR over 2T. So what we have is the maximum normal stress in the spherical vessel going to be smaller than the maximum stress in the cylindrical. So in the petrochemical industry, you will see a lot of ball, the spherical ball that's used to store the natural gas or compressive natural gas. And also based upon this knowledge, if you go back to see the natural gas in the mom chicken, like a PTT, you will see they need to weld the tank in this direction Why they always well the tank in this direction? Because in this direction, the welding going to subject sigma sub 2. So they won't weld in this direction because in this direction, the weld going to subjected PR over 2. So it's going to be easier to weld the tank in this direction. Okay, so we have this discussion on the first portion of this chapter. You may go and take a look at it. So this is the reason why petrochemical industry have this kind of spherical storage tank. Okay, and also the what's so called the welding. Okay, of cylindrical vessel such as the pipe, they always weld in this direction, always weld in this direction because it's subjected to smaller pressure vessel. So petrochemical student, when you talk with your professor in the future, okay, about how to storage the gas or storage the high compression fluid, was the best way to use the spherical vessel. And now, more important equation, again, I'm going to focus on these three. And then the problem that I just showed you in the previous slide is a kind of two-dimensional problem. We work on these three equations, and in two-dimensional problem with various examples from the previous lecture, we will focus on the three dimension. Okay, we on again these three equations, and then when you have all of them, you can see these two, they are normal stress. So you can combine them. How to combine them? You can combine them by using the principle of superposition in order to get the stress. So the total normal stress most of the time can be N over A plus, let's say plus or minus, and then MY over I. And if you use this principle of superposition, you will get the resultant normal stress, okay? And also, if the problem is the spherical like this, you have the tau equal to TR over J, you may combine them also with the VQ over IT. But most of the time, we didn't focus on the circle. We focus on the section that is a kind of rectangular section. And then the assumption required for the principle of superposition is the linear elastic. It means the stress over here must be less than on or equal to sigma sub y, and the tau also less than or equal to tau sub y, and the deformation of the structure must be very small. Now, let us move to the example. Okay, in this respect, we have this 15 Newton, and then follow the first step. You can cut the section, and then you can determine this is the normal force, and this is the moment. So the normal force will be normal stress is going to be normal force divided by the A. You will get the answer over here. And then for the sigma equal to MY over I, you get the results here. And then this is what? This is in tension, which is in opposite to this is in compression. So this one and this one require the subtraction. However, if you move this one to this portion, they are in compression. So it requires the addition. Based on this, This is going to be 11.25 plus 3.75. So the stress on this portion is going to be 15, 11.25 plus 3.75. And for the also one over here, the stress is plus the tension, 11.25 minus 3.75. So the stress over here is 7.5 megapascal. One requirement is the slope that we have based upon the rate divided by this 10x is going to be equal to the green, and then divide this this 10, the total 100, this is 100 millimeter minus x, so you will have 15 divided 100 minus x, and then it's going to equal to the 7.5 divided by the this 10x, then you may be able to determine the new location of the neutral axis. So x going to be equal something. This is the new location of the neutral axis. Typically for this structure, the location of the neutral axis is at the middle. Okay. And then there are the detail of this example over here. Let me take you a bit, follow the step. Okay. You get the normal force, you get the moment, and then you can determine the normal stress due to the normal force, due to the normal stress, due to the bending moment. Okay, and then what we discussed is this one, and then for point B, you will get the stress element like this, and then for the point C, it's going to be over here. The normal stress is going to be this one, and subjected to larger stress. And follow what we have over here. One year, Ajahn also asked you to determine the new position of x. You can solve this one and get the x of 33.3 millimeter. So this one is going to be 66.7 millimeter. And you can see the new location of the neutral axis move, okay, from half of the depth of 50 millimeter to the new location. And then what we have is there is an example, okay, over here that's going to be one of the examination, and this one is a kind of simple one. And why I said that, because this is up on this, the rigid frame is in symmetry. What is mean symmetry? You may see the application of the force, they act passing to half of the width. Okay, it's kind of the same problem that we have just discussed on the PowerPoint, and it's a bit harder because now the force act in this cantilever portion. But don't worry, based up on what we have, we got to do the same thing. What we got to do from this problem, you don't need to determine the reaction. However, you got to draw free body diagram and use the equation of equilibrium to determine internal
force and internal moment. Again, this problem is in three dimension. Do we need to draw this one in three dimension? Because it seemed to me very hard. Actually, you may do the drawing like this if you prefer, but I won't recommend it. Okay, it's going to take some time to do so, but you may refer to this one is in symmetry. So if this one is in symmetry, you may just draw only the portion of this one. Let me put this one in 2 centimeter. Let me cut it in 2 centimeter. So this is going to be about like a 3.5. And then let me put it about 3.5. And then there is the curve over here. And let's put it again, this is about 2. And this is also about 2 something. Let me put it like this one. And then what you guys has, this is going to be this portion. And this is going to be this portion. And you get the section in the free body diagram of this section in 2 dimension like this. Just make a copy of it as similar to the original as possible. And following this one, you may have this one for 200. Okay, the unit is what? The unit is in millimeter. Okay, you may put this one in millimeter. So that is going to be the total of this height. And then this is 300. So you just do this one and put this one into 300 millimeter. And then on this portion is 200. So this part of this portion, if you divide it, it can be half-half. You need to divide it because half of it gonna be the centroid of the section. So this is gonna be 100 millimeter. This is gonna be 100 millimeter. And then what? The structure subjected to the force that is on the top of 80 kilonewton. And then based upon this one, 300, this is 200. You will know this is going to be 100 millimeter. And you also have the force that occur over here. Let's say this is going to be the normal force. And this is going to be the centroid of the section. You can see 80 kilonewton will rotate clockwise. So over here, for sure, you will have this one as the moment. Then you may set this is Y, this is X, okay? And then follow this one, the point A is here. So this is going to be the A, and this is going to be the B. And then you use the equation of equilibrium, summation of F sub Y equal to 0. So the normal force is upward, put it to be positive. So N is going to be equal to 80 kilonewton. Very simple, right? Compared to the example that we have, you need more skill, a bit more. And then you may use the same concept. So more of the moment, do summation about the centroid over here. And the counterclockwise is the positive. So the M is going to be equal to 80 kilonewton times the distance from here to here. And you can see this is 100. This also 100, right? So you have this one M equal to 80 kilonewton times 0.2 meter. So you have this one to be 16 kilonewton meter. So the first step is like this one. Then what we have is the second one. After you get the results of this, and it is the internal force and internal moment, and they require us to indicate the direction. So you guys got to indicate the direction of N, okay? And also of the moment, like this one, in order to provide the direction that act on this section C. Then we move to the second step. On the second step, we will determine the internal is stasis. Based upon this one, you have only two steps. That's sigma equal to N over A and sigma equal to My over I. There is no shear force. Then based upon this one, we have the example on the shear force, okay, from the previous lecture. If you like to consider that, you may go back to our video clip. And then what I have is we going to project the stress that occur on the portion over here. If you just use this portion, you may take this portion, or if you don't like it, you like to draw the stress that acts up on this portion on the bottom, you also can do so. It's up to you, but I should tell you guys that if you draw on this one, the stress will subjected to the normal force like this one. Okay, if you draw bases on this, this one will subjected to the normal force like this. It's up to you use the top or the bottom portion. Okay, and then for this one, the moment is like this. For this one, the moment is like this. So based upon this, you guys should consider which portion you prefer to. But okay, based upon this, let me put on both of them on the top portion and also on the bottom portion. In others, you guys will see the difference between them. Let me start by this equation. Based upon the normal force, you will get this one as the average normal force distributed in the same direction of the normal force, okay? And for this portion, you will get the normal stress in the same direction of the normal force, and you will get sigma equal to the normal force is 80 kilonewton. So 80,000 newton. And then what going to be the section? This is the length of 200. This is going to be 200. And this is the length of 100. So it's going to divided by 200 and times 100. That is millimeter square. So again, based upon this, you will get this normal stress equal to 4 megapascal. Okay, 4 megapascal. And based upon the moment over here, this portion going to be in compression. For sure, this is in compression. And this one will be in tension. And we have the centroid over here. So the stress that's due to this sigma equal to my over I will have this kind of stress. And then on the bottom portion that we consider, you will get the stress that in the opposite direction based upon Newton third law. And this is going to be in opposite direction. This is going to be in the opposite direction. So you get the stress in the opposite direction, but they are equal. Equal to what? Equal to this one. The moment is 16,000 Newton meter. And then you got to measure from here to here. And as you may see, this is going to be 100 millimeter. Or if you like, you measure to here. Here is also 100 millimeter. So it's going to be 0.1 meter. It's up to you, right? If you prefer millimeter, you got to change this one to millimeter. So I use meter. That means this change to 0.1. How about the moment of inertia? Now, the moment of inertia will be the moment of inertia about C. And based upon this one, there is the section that requires the consideration over here. And based upon this one, you need to have centroid, half of the length over here. And also half of the length over here of 100 millimeter, 100 millimeter. So the moment of inertia must be the one that's rotated about this axis, okay, which is the centroid axis. And then based upon this, the I will be equal to, this is 100, 0.1. This is 200, 0.2 cubed, okay? And then divided by 12, you will get this one to be 66.67, 10 minus 6 meter powerful. You take 66.67 and 10 minus 6 meter powerful. And this is meter cut, this is Newton per meter square. So you get the result of this one to be 24 mega Pascal. Now you have the normal stress. This is 24 mega Pascal. This is 24 mega Pascal. You may combine the stress. If you like to combine the stress, you got to refer to the third step by using the principle of superposition. We will get the result. We can combine the stresses. The stresses as shown. Okay, based upon this, we just combine them. When we combine them, we got another result. Let me put it over here. And then this is going to be one of the portion. Which one you prefer to use? Most of the time, we prefer to use the bottom one. Again, may I use the top one? Yes, you can. And they're going to provide the same result. Okay. So based upon this, this is compression. This is tension. So when you combine them, for sure, the tension is going to be plus 24 and the compression going to be minus 4. So you get this one to be 20 mega Pascal. And for another portion, this is compression. This is compression. They are in the same direction, minus 24, minus 4. So this one going to be the total of 28 mega Pascal. But you can use the minus over here because the direction of the arrow show already. So just put it 28, no minus sign. Okay, and then you will get the new location. This is the old centroid, and it's required to change to this new one. So the stress is going to be like this. On this portion, it's gonna be like this one. Now, it may need to determine the new location of the centroid or the neutral axis. This one should be the neutral axis, new neutral axis. And this one can be X. Since all of this is 200, this is 200 minus X, okay? And then you may determine it very easy. 20 divided by X, and then it's going to be equal to 28, and then divided by 200. Minus X, you may solve this one and get X equal to 83.33 millimeter for this new location of the neutral axis. Okay, and then they require us toward going back point A and point B. This is the point A, this is the point B. So on the force, we draw the stress A element at A and B. You can see for the A is over here, the stress is in tension. So just put this one as the A and another one over here as the B. Is a material point. We represent it by a square, okay, at any side, proper size. And then over here is in tension, and you get this is going to be the sigma equal to 20 mega pascal. And it is in y direction. So this is sigma sub y at point A. And for this one, it is in compression. So this is sigma sub y at point B equal to, this is 28 mega pascal. So this is one of the final examination, okay, many years ago, and they just use the example from the PowerPoint and do some modification, require some of your skill on this kind of calculation. The steps gonna be something like this for three-dimensional problem. Now, there is a more complex problem also. Let me take you back to the PowerPoint. On the PowerPoint of this example, we have it already, right? If you guys will recall it, go back to my video clip from the previous lecture, and I will move a bit more. This problem is special, okay? They have what? They have the shear stress that occur on the section. It's not only the normal stress and the moment that we have discussed. So this example is an extension on the problem here. And believe me, this example come before this one. And when it come, the problem like this, the author will harder. But if you get the examination like this, another problem such as problem number two will be easier. So don't worry.
when one is hard, another one will be easy. And then let you guys to go back, you can compute for stresses at a given point, and then you can draw the stress element that occur on that. Now, not only the normal force occur compared to the previous one, you have the, sorry, not only the normal force occur and provide the normal stress. Now, the shear stress also provide the shear force also provide the shear stress, which following this one is 1.33 megapascal. Now, there is another one, but this one is a bit complicated. And let me show you guys one thing. When we talk about the kind of this problem, is a kind of section have by moment. This problem has the moment about y and about x. And if you like to consider it, you may see they provide you already the normal force. And then this one is easy. No, because we have the moment over here. This is going to be the moment about y axis. This one is going to be the moment about this y axis. What you do is you got to use your hand, use your hand, and then four of the finger follow the light blue. If you follow the light blue on the M sub Y, think, you will see this light blue will put the compression, will put the compression on this one. Can you imagine it? The arrow, you see the arrow of the light blue is put into the DE. Okay, so the DE is going to be in compression due to this moment. And for sure, AB will have the tension by this 16 kilonewton. Okay, and this is going to provide the normal stress as the normal force. Now, let me take you guys to this one, the green. The green is going to be the moment that's rotated about this x axis. And I should call this one as the M sub x. And again, four finger. You may put this four finger and your four finger will compare on the BC. Now, what we have is the new stress occur due to this 8 kilonewton, will have the stress of this one. And then this portion will subjected to the tension. Okay, that require a lot of consideration. Ajahn, how this kind of stress come? Actually, Ajahn may help you a bit, because in reality, this moment cannot come alone as you previously see. Sometimes we have, let's say, this is going to be the X, right? And this is going to be the Y axis. Based upon what we discuss, when we talking about the moment of M sub Y, the light blue is going to be the stress that occur about, let's say, this axis. Then how it come? There is a force maybe act over here. Okay, let's say if you have a force X over here, this is going to be our static problem. When the force, let's say
40 kilonewton acts in the what so called not on the centroid of the section. Okay, you got to do something. You got to put this one into one thing. It's going to be a bit hard to draw the picture. Let me put it like this. This one. Let me draw it again. There's supposed to be three of this section. Okay, let me put it. The drawing is so bad. Okay, let me put it like this. This is first. This is the second. And this is going to be the third. Why I can't do like this? Because due to the force X over here, first of the thing, you got to again locate the centroid of each section, and you can transfer the force. Let me put this one over here from that location to the centroid. When you move the force of 40 kilonewton to the centroid, what happened is you can move it directly if you prefer, but there is two things that you got to consider. First, the force of 40 kilonewton has some eccentricity. Talking about this eccentricity, if you times 40 kilonewton with this yellow, okay, you will have this one rotate in the same direction of this. Okay, for a proper value of the yellow, you will get the moment that's rotate about the X axis. So based upon this, you will get the moment on this one. You may dock it with the double arrow, and this moment is going to be 40 times the distance over here. That is going to be in this direction times Y, and based upon this is going to be 80 kilonewton meter. And then there is another eccentricity that is over here. Okay, and based upon this one, you may see this will produce the moment in this direction, which is 16 kilonewton. So you get this one to be M sub Y equal to 40 times the distance over here is in the X direction. So it's just time X. Following this one is 16 kilonewton meter. What Ajahn trying to explain here is what? There always another step from the example. If Ajahn won't provide you with N, with M sub Y, also with M sub X, they will ask you to find, okay, to find the moment over here is going to be the moment about X, M sub X and M sub Y. And the problem going to be a bit harder. If you able to use the engineering static to find the M sub X and M sub Y of this one, you're going to be in good condition. If not, what we am going to teach you will not provide a good answer. Okay, so I ask you again to go back to the engineering static. Use the free body diagram and equation of equilibrium. Okay, this is going to be the second example. And then not only that, there is another thing about the moment
about the axis. There is two axes over here. One is this one. Okay. Typically, I should start. This may be, let's say, 100. Okay. This may be like 150. The rectangular section have one that's longer than the other one. The square, they are equal. Okay. And then based upon this, the moment of inertia about the red axis is going to be 100 times 100 cubed over 12. Okay, so let's say this is the x axis. I sub x will be larger than the I sub y because the I sub y will be 150 times 100 cubed divided by 12. But the I sub x, will be 100 times 150 cubed divided by 12. Can you see the difference? Then the moment come. The moment that rotate in this direction, in which direction? In the x direction, okay, will require I sub x. Okay, thinking about the moment in x direction require I sub x. And the moment in y direction require I sub y. It's going to be in this way. Okay, if you can understand this, you will be able to taking care of this problem. Now, let me take you back to what you have on this one. After you able to determine all the internal force and all the internal moment, let me just take this one out to be easier and show this class and show it again. That's me. Take you to this one. Okay, now everything clear again. There is two moments on this problem. One is going to be, let me put it M sub X, and let's say this is going to be M sub X. Why I call this one M sub X? Because if I draw this one, the double head is in that green direction, then this M sub X require I sub X. And I should say this one will require the moment about this one. So I sub X is going to be the width of this one, BC. It's going to be 0.8 times 0.4 cubed divided by 12. And then there is the M sub Y. This is going to be M sub Y because if you put your finger, your thumb will take the red arrow. And this is going to rotate in what? Rotate about this axis. So this is going to be I sub y equal to what? Equal to dB, 0.4 times 0.8 cubed divided by 12. Okay, now let me take this one. For the normal force, the problem going to be very easy because the normal force from chapter one is going to be sigma equal to normal force divided by A. It's going to be 40 kilonewton divided by cross-sectional area. So all of them is in compression. Due to N is in compression. Then we start with the moment of 8 kilonewton, the green moment that we just discuss on this green moment is going to be in this direction, and then this side, this portion is going to be in compassion, as I explained to you guys already. And on this portion is going to be in tension. Then there is the zero over here, and then also zero over here. So you get the stress distribution like this. A more beautiful in here. Okay, the size between BC is in compression, and the size from A to D, that is in tension, and there is a middle here. The stress is zero. So M, and then you measure from here to here. You measure from here to here, or from here to here is 0.2. And then we have the I about this axis is 0.8 times 0.4 cube divided by 12. You got 375 kilonewton. And then there is another M sub Y. Now, this is M sub Y, and this is M sub Y, because if you draw the double arrow, use your finger is in this direction, and this M sub Y provide the compression again on this portion, and provide the tension on this portion, and in between there is the zero value of the stress, and then the I is going to be about this Y direction. The beautiful one is going to be here. You may stop video if you prefer, and trying to generate the picture by yourself. And this is 16 times, this is the Y, they are equal, okay? This is half of the depth. And the moment of inertia is about this axis. So it's going to be 0.4 times 0.8 cubed over 12. You got the same answer of 375. In the big picture, they all be like this one. You got to combine point by point. Let me first by taking this one. This is compression, okay? This is tension. This is tension. So at this point, it's going to be minus 125 plus 375 plus 375. So on the first one over here, or the first one over here, is going to be result of this one, minus 125 plus, and then this one plus. So over here is 625. Now for the second one, you take this one, the B. This is minus 125. Let me put it like this, minus 125. This is going to be minus 375. However, this one is in tension, it's plus. So this one is going to be minus compression 125. Okay. And then for the third one, let me put it in C. For the C, okay, this one is in compression minus. This one is in compression minus. And this one is in compression. Is the largest 875 kilonewton, kilopascal, sorry. Okay. And then for the last one that we have point D. For the point D, we start by the same minus, and this one is in tension plus, this one is in compression minus. So the last one that we have is in compression of 125. Now you get very complicated, okay, pictures, but one important thing, only the one that change from plus to minus requires zero. If, for example, this portion, they always in compression. So since they always in compression, there is no zero point. The same occur over here. There is always compression. So this portion has no zero. Then when you compare the other side of this one is in tension, this one compression. So this one must be have a zero point. Also this one must have a zero point. Okay, and then this is going to be the surface of the tension, the surface of the tension. And this one is going to be the surface of the compression. There is the axis along this one. That is going to be the axis of zero stress. What we call it is going to be the neutral axis. And the location of the E and the H, you can determine the same as the previous example. Use the same slope, okay? For example, if you like to find the E, this is 125, 125 divided by, this is 125 divided by E equal to this one, equal to this one of 625 divided by this one, 0.4 minus E. You can determine E, right? Okay, and then for the H, you also able to, this is 625 times this one, 625, sorry, divided by this one, divided by 0.8 minus H. And then it's going to be this one, 125, and then divided by H, you will get H equal to something in meter. For this one, you will get E equal to something in meter. And then you can locate, if you have 2 points, you can locate the neutral axis of this section. This one is going to be the most complicated problem, okay? Actually, there is another one by Ajahn Ekawut many years ago. That is too much complicated. We won't make that kind of examination again. That's also in your extra example. If you prefer, it's a cantilever beam subjected to the force and they are the bipolar. And this is for chapter 8, okay? Let me stop over here for about 5 minutes. I will take you to the chapter 9. Then this is going to be our second session on this lecture. Let me take you back to the previous chapter on chapter 1, chapter 6, chapter 7 up to chapter 8. What we get from that called the stress distribution. And from the stress distribution that I just drew it from the first section, you can draw what's so called the stress element. The stress element is a kind of material point. And then on the second problem, Ajahn will provide you a new stress element. And Ajahn will given this is the XY axis. And the stress that act on the stress element can be this one, this called normal stress in the x direction, and in this tension is positive, and we also another one that's in the y direction. We have this one, and we call this one sigma in y direction. Normal stress in the y direction. Tension is positive, and then due to the shear stress, there are four of them. 1, 2, 3, and 4. So we call this one tau in the xy plane. And tau in xy plane require a reference surface. We put the reference surface over here. This reference surface, the tau point up. So this tau is positive. This is very first step. If you read the state element wrong, all calculation after that going to be wrong. Okay, so the stress element is given. Then what they are asking you for the stress element, they ask you to determine the principal stress. What is the principal stress? Principal stress will be the stress sigma 1 and sigma 2. And over here, there is no tau. Since there is no tau, the principal stress, one of them, gonna be maximum, okay? And another one is gonna be the minimum. And it will occur if you rotate this one for a given angle. That's going to be the angle, let's say theta sub 1. If you rotate it into the theta sub 1, you will get the stress element rotate in a new direction. And since it's rotate in sigma sub 1, the stress corresponding is going to be the stress sigma sub 1. And the stress that occur with the sigma sub 1 is going to be sigma sub 2. So this is going to be sigma sub 1, and this is going to be sigma sub 2. Then not only that, you may require to rotate into another angle we call theta sub S1. Before this one is P1, that's sub S1. That is another rotation. And now that one will provide you with the maximum shear stress. And the maximum shear stress will occur with the sigma average. So the new state of stress will be this one, going to be the tau max. However, the tau max occur with what's so called the sigma average. This is the requirement for you. And then there is two methods to do it. I will point you to the Mohr circle. And when we talking about the Mohr circle, you got to have the compass. Everybody will need the compass to do the homework, also to do the examination. And the projector ruler like this, because you need to measure the angle that I just mentioned. Okay, so you got to have it. And then we will find the failure plane. After you draw a new stress element, you will get this one. And this one typically is not what we ask in the subject. We ask the failure plane in advanced mechanics of material. So based on this, in the calculation, we will have three, I think, homework. If you can do these three homework, I'm very sure you guys can solve the problem. What the evidence that we need to do the stress transformation? Thinking about this beam, when you test the beam, you find the crack is in this direction. That is not correct because our calculation, we cut the section in this given way in the vertical, and then we may calculate the stress on the stress element in the reference to the X and Y axis. Since this one is not in the XY axis, it's in this new axis. That means there is something occur. And that something occur is large enough to fail the material of the structure. That is the evidence that the stress that we use the anisotropic and mechanics of material is not the one who caused the crack, but the rotation of the stress element caused the new higher stresses that caused the crack. Now, what's going to be the angle? Okay, you can do the computation and compare with the experiment by doing this one. The new element gonna be like this, and then mathematics come. The stress that we may have it in three dimension, X, Y, Z, the total of them going to be sigma sub X, sigma sub Y, sigma sub Z, and tau sub X, Y, tau sub X, Z, and tau sub Y, Z. But in reality, most of our structure has three-dimensional states of stresses. So sigma sub Z, tau sub X Z, and also tau sub Y Z assumed to be zero when compared to the other stresses. So our world now can simplify to the new stress element, and we call it the plane stress problem. Now, we will draw our stress element like this. And again, all of the stresses occur on the stress element can be determined by using the knowledge from chapter 1 to chapter 8. And Ajahn will give the stress of stress to you, and you got to follow the psi convention. I said psi convention the second time, because when you read the stress wrong, every calculation will be wrong. The tension will be positive. The tension will be positive. For tau sub xy, we use this one as the reference surface. And if tau sub xy on the reference surface point up, the shear stress is positive. And then for this one, there is the new shear stresses. If you rotate this one counterclockwise by the angle theta, and counterclockwise is positive, there is a new stresses. This is sigma sub x prime. And for sure, this is going to be sigma sub y prime. And then this is going to be tau sub x prime y prime. And that will change with the angle theta. And positive is going to be counterclockwise. And then what is going to be the new stress? The textbook from Professor Hippler. Okay, you can go through it, or you may go to my textbook if you prefer in Thai. You will get the equation like this one. Sigma sub x prime will be calculated
from this one. This always the know value. And I should point out on this equation, the angle that's used in the equation is 2 theta. And then when Professor Moore developed the Moore circle, the 2 theta gonna be another important point. What occurred in the Moore circle is 2 theta. What occurred in the real structure, real stress element is going to be half of that. Okay, this is second important thing. If Ajahn, can I use this equation to do the calculation? We won't recommend because it's very hard to remember. Okay, we like you guys to develop skill. Okay, skill is more important than remembering. When you remember something, when you go out of the examination room, everything just gone. If you have some skill, there is something still with you. Okay, so I won't recommend. And then from this one, we have a lot of example, and it's going to be very easy if you can remember the equation again. One important thing, this is compressive stress. This is going to be minus 80, okay? And this is tension, is positive. For the tau, you got to use this reference. Now, guys, 25 megapascal is downward. So tau sub xy is going to be minus. Even Tom said, hey, in soil mechanics, they use different size convention. Yes, because inside convention of the structure, we take the tension at the positive. But in soil mechanics, soil lock take the compression at the positive because they can resist more in compression and they can receive the tension. So don't worry, by the Moore circle, with the different size convention, you will get the same state element. Now, what the rotation? You got the clockwise. When you got the clockwise, the size of this angle is negative. And the problem is very easy. Just put everything in the equation and put everything in the calculator properly in the degree. Okay, you got to set the calculator in degree. And then you will get the result. This one from sigma sub x, sigma sub y, tau sub x, y, and the rotation, you get sigma sub x prime to be minus 25.8. And you get new tau sub x prime to be minus 68.8. And you get tau sub x, sorry, sigma sub y to be minus 4.15. Okay. And that is going to be the rotation of the element. And this is going to be what so called the new stress of stasis. And convenient, right? But it won't be good. And also, you need to find the principal stasis and the maximum in plane shear stress. Since all the function that you have is the function of the theta, you can determine the maximum and minimum of the equation from what? The maximum and the minimum can be determined from what? From differentiation of this function with respect to the variable theta, and you put it equal to zero. That means it's going to be maximum or minimum when the slope is zero. The curve going to be like this, right? On the top or the bottom, get the zero value on the top and on the bottom. Then you do the differentiation of this equation. You take it equal to zero, you get the angle See, can you remember it? That is another equation, and that's required to solve for the angle of principal stress. And then there is two of them, one principal angle for sigma 1, we call it theta sub p 1. One is the principal angle for theta 2, that's called theta sub p 2. They are 90 degree different. They are 90 degree different. Oh, that's quite a lot of equation. Yes, there are quite a lot of equation. And then on this PowerPoint, we may take the angle and then we plug the angle into this equation. We will get the state of principal stress to have zero shear. Now, that's quite a lot of equation, not yet. We also require to find the maximum shear, okay? And then for the, sorry, we also require the maximum normal stress. When you plug the stress, the angle into the equation of the stress, and you will get the value of the sigma 1 and sigma 2. Now, you got to do another thing. The maximum principal stress usually cause the failure of brittle material, such as cast iron. For example, in the railway of the new high-speed train of Thailand, okay, also for the concrete, also for the lock. But there is the ductile material, such as steel. Steel or aluminum fail by the shear stress, it get necking before it fail. And then there is the differentiation of the function of shear and set it to be zero. You get another angle that's used to determine the maximum in plane shear stress. That is another set of equation. Okay, if you put in the paper, that's covered close to a page of paper for all the equation. Can you remember it? I don't think so for me, and you may, okay. And then there is the theta sub S1 for positive tau max and theta sub S2 for negative tau max. And again, for sigma 1, sigma 2, there is no tau, okay? Cause the failure of brittle material. For tau max, is different. Tau max can be determined by putting this into this, the theta, into the equation. You put this stress, sorry, this angle into the shear stress equation. This is the equation for the tau max. Wow, that's quite a lot of equation. Not enough. When you put the equation and then take it into the consideration of the angle that we have, we found that tau max occur with the sigma average. Okay, principal stress occur with tau equal to zero, different. And then that is going to be a lot of things. When you minus the principal stress, you will get the tau max equal to sigma 1 minus sigma 2 divided by 2. Oh, I come to this one. Now come to this one. This one of what? We come to another state of stress of the stress element. First step, read what is sigma x. This one is going to be positive or negative? Negative, right? This one going to be positive. This one going to be positive. Now we have minus 20, plus 90, and plus 60. We like to determine what principal stresses and maximum in plane shear stresses. We have the equation. If you remember, just put everything,
you get sigma 1, sigma 2 with very careful calculation. And what's the angle? Okay, after you get sigma 1, sigma 2, you may put it into the equation and then you get the angle. But you got to check the angle is going to be theta sub p1 or theta sub p2. You got to check by putting this one into this equation. That requires a lot of calculation to check it. We found this one corresponding to sigma 2. So what you get over here is going to be theta sub p2. You see, this is not convenient at all. And also, theta sub p1 will occur 90 degree different. You will get theta sub p1 later. That's require a lot of computation now. For this one, you rotate for negative. When you rotate negative, that means you rotate clockwise. You get this one for 23.75 now. The projector ruler come. You got to measure for that angle. And there is an element. Ajahn, why don't we put the new element on top of this one? No, it's going to mess up everything. They just extend it out, okay, to see a clearer picture. This is the stress state of principal stress. And if this is occur on the concrete, this is going to be the crack because this is the largest normal stress that pull the concrete to make the crack. And you get this is the crack direction on the concrete. Now, for the maximum in-plane shear stress, okay, you can find the angle. Just put everything into this equation. You get the angle to theta sub s and half of it gonna be over here. And if it's positive, that means it's gonna be in the counterclockwise direction, okay? But you got to check because maximum in-plane shear stress can be positive and can be negative. You got again check whether it's going to be which one, and then you get the angle. This one put into the tau max. You get this is positive, so this is theta sub s one. Okay, and then this is going to be theta sub s one, and then the maximum in-plane shear stress occur with the average normal stress. You can determine it in this value. And for counterclockwise rotation, you get a new state of stress. And then if this is the steel, this is going to be the failure, okay? Failure plane of the steel. And since the stress shear, okay, negative or positive provide the same value. This is also can call the failure plane of the steel, both black and red. Okay, it can be two of them. And compared to the principal stress, you can see these two states of stress will be 45 degree different. They are 45 degree different. And this is not convenient at all in our calculation. Then I have another 15 minutes coming to more circle. More circle going to be a very convenient in determining the principal stresses and the angle, in determining the maximum in-plane shear stress and the angle, in determining any stresses for, let's say, theta equal to positive 30 degree, or for determining sigma sub x prime, sigma sub y prime, tau sub x prime y prime. Okay, there are going to be three important questions. First is going to be this one. Second they ask you to determine sigma 1 theta sub p 1 and sigma 2 theta sub p 2 okay and then also the last one positive tau mag and theta sub s 1 and then occur with the sigma average and also negative tau max and then theta sub s 2 and also sigma average there is going to be second question and third question and typically อาจารย์ will ask you only two of the three okay and now how can we develop it first of all the development of more circle basis or the equation the same equation that we have the stress transformation equation with the angle of 2 theta so everything on the Mohr circle is 2 theta and the real thing will be half of that and professor let's see Mohr he is very and let me pass this one very smart on the mathematics he took two of the three equations and then he just moved this portion and moved it to be on this one and then sigma sub x minus this one is the left side and then this is going to be the right side and then he takes square of this he takes square of this on the second equation he just takes square of this and take square of this and he combine this left portion and combine the right portion he get the result on the mathematics in the function like this one and what we have is similar to the equation of x if this one of x minus h square and then take this one as the y plus y square and take this one as r square he found that that is the circle equation and this circle equation with the center with the center of what of h zero and radius and the radius and he get the equation on these pictures okay and for this one when we draw the Mohr circle we determine the center of the Mohr circle the center of the Mohr circle will be h zero it's going to be sigma average zero and then the second you got to have square root of this one this is going to be r equal to the square root of this one you got to remember two things the middle the center and the radius by doing this one you plot the center and then you draw the radius and then the stresses on the right hand side is going to be the location on the circle and this one is going to be sigma x and tau sub xy you may put this one sigma x and tau sub xy and then from the center if you project over here this is going to be sigma sub y and tau minus tau sub xy that is going to be this one how can know it because this is 90 degree and on this one is 180 degree and I always said 2 theta on Mohr circle is half in the real problem and then sigma sub y minus tau sub xy on the Mohr circle you don't know anything this is going to be maximum
So you get sigma 1 0. Okay, this is going to be minimum normal stress. Just lead it from the Mohr circle, and then for the tau max, you just take this one down over here. This is going to be sigma average. Since this one is sigma average 0, and then plus tau max, and if you take it upward, you got this is sigma average and minus tau max. That means you get 50 or 60% from the problem already. Just draw a circle and lead it from the circle. Very simple, right? And then you may determine this one. This one you rotate to sigma 1. You use the trigonometry. You get this one to theta sub p 1. Trigonometry of what? You have this value, tau sub x y, right? And then you can determine this value. You will get tan of what? Tan of tau sub x, tan 2 theta p 1 tau sub x y divided by this one. This one is what? The total of this one is going to be sigma x. This is sigma x. And this is sigma y. It's only sigma x minus sigma y divided by 2. So you get the angle. And when you get this to theta sub p 1, the angle over here is going to 2 theta sub s 1. 2 theta sub s 1 will be equal to 90 degrees minus 2 theta sub p 1. That's it. You get all the states of stress of the principal stress and for the tau maximum. Okay, you can study from the PowerPoint if you prefer, and then you will get this one for the stress of principal stress, and all of thing can do by drawing the Mohr circle. And very important, the angle on the Mohr circle 2 times the angle of what occur over here. For the in plane, also the same thing, but now you use the vertical line. That is going to be maximum for the vertical, and this one going to be the minimum on the Mohr circle. And then you will see what Mohr circle show. You don't need to remember those kind of equation. You can have everything from this one. Okay, let me start for a quick one. So first, this is positive or negative? Negative 20. This is positive 20. For this one, 60 is going to be upward, positive. And then the average is very easy, plus 90. Okay, plus 90. We'll combine with this one and divide it by 2. The center of the Mohr circle is going to be 70 divided by 2. That is going to be 35.0. And then for the radius, you got to do the a bit calculation, but the equation is not that hard. Okay, it can be this one. So the radius is going to be 81.4. So you have the center at 35.0. You draw the circle, use the compass for 81.4. You get the circle. And then the state of stress over here is minus 20 and minus 3 and 60. This is 0, 0. You just move this one for what? Minus 20. And then you just draw it down. It will reach this point with the tau of 60. When I say that the Mohr circle require positive downward. Okay, this is for structural engineering side convention. And then Ajahn can see this one for what? You can see this is going to be what? This is going to be 35.0. And then this is the radius. So this is going to be 35 + 81.40, and this is sigma 1.0. You get sigma 1. And for this one, you take this one back for 85.1. So it's going to be 35 - 81.40. This is sigma 2.0. Okay. And then from this one, you take this one downward over here. This is 35. This is 35. This is the length of the radius plus 81.4. Very easy, right? And this is what, take this one up over here. This is 35. This is 35. And minus 81.4 because this is tau. Okay. Now, you can measure the angle. And the angle is very easy. This is what you rotate to sigma 2. This is 2 theta sub p 2. This is what? This is going to be 60. So, tan of 2 theta sub p 2 equal to this one, 60, divided by what? Divided by the distance on the horizontal. This is 20. This is 20, right? And this is another 35. So this is going to be 55. You can determine 2 theta sub p2. Okay. And then from this one, you may find 2 theta sub p1. Since the angle over here to here is 180, 2 theta sub p1 is 180 minus 2 theta sub p2. You get the angle. And then also, you may determine this one. This one is what? This one is 2 theta sub s1. So 2 theta sub s1 equal to, this is 90 degree minus 2 theta sub p2. You don't need to like it. Everything going to follow what we going to do it later. Okay. This one and this one. You get it, right? And then for the angle, you got to start by this one over here, call this one phi. Okay. So the phi is going to be the one over here of 60. And then we have for this one. This one is minus 20. Measure to here. This is 20. And then there is what? There is another 35. This is 35. So tan phi will be 60 divided 55. So phi is going to be this one. And then you determine what? You determine 2 theta sub p1. So you got to have this one for 180. This is 180 minus phi. You got this one, 2 theta sub p1. And then you get 132.5. And then you get 63.3 half of it. And this is positive. It's going to be counterclockwise. So you get the result of this one counterclockwise. For to this one, phi is going to be, phi is going to be 2 theta sub p2. So theta sub p2 is half. Theta sub p2 is going to be 23.75 degree and rotate in this direction. So you get the result of this one. Okay, if you dock it based on theta sub p1, counterclockwise for 66.3. And for another one, if you dock it into 23.75, you may have another one here, okay, and they are 90 degree different, and what you get is going to be the same thing. The same thing of what? The same thing of the crack will occur on the sigma one. Will occur on the sigma one. And what we get from this example is it the same as the previous one? That's we use the equation. You can see from your PowerPoint. And tau max is going to be the height here and the height here. Okay, it's only positive and negative. And then the angle is going to be this angle. That is 2 theta sub s1. In reality, it's only half. And this is going to be counterclockwise. So you may dock it in the form of this one. Okay. And then compare the maximum normal principal stress and maximum shear stress. You will get the result like this. I should finish this lecture here. And I like you guys to study the third question by yourself. And next time I will show you guys again with this three types of question by using the Mohr circle. And the examination gonna be like this. I think I have put the extra example to you guys already. Next time, print them out, bring these two. And we will work together. You should not lecture kid on the iPad or notepad or any pad. You got to practice by hand calculation, okay? Because it's going to be what you do in the examination room. Okay, thank you. Bye-bye.